This video was sponsored by The Great Courses Plus. It's a service where you have instantaneous access to lectures by top professors. One of these lectures inspired the creation of this video, so stay tuned till the end to find out more.
When many people think about the history of Russia, this comes to mind. The Soviet Union, its reign over the 20th century, the Cold War, and its eventual fall. But what isn't talked about as much was before this. After all, the Soviet Union had to rise from something, so what exactly was Russia before the revolution? Well, as many of you know, Russia was controlled by a Tsar. Functioning as all-powerful king of the land, the Tsar was believed to be endowed with this power from God himself, so questioning him wasn't often tolerated. By the late 19th century, Russia had been controlled by the Romanov family, a dynasty which had ruled for nearly 300 years. Russia had a distinct culture ingrained with its heavily orthodox religious beliefs. Stability? Sure. But at the same time, you had the obvious faults with the Tsarist system, as with any authoritarian system. Class division was strict and integral to society. You had the poor, the middle class, the elite. You were born into class, and moving about was just not likely. While this worked for much of history, the advent of the printing press, better education, and better technology in general began to educate a previously uneducated lower class. Apparently clear in 1881, Alexander II, Tsar of Russia, was brutally killed in an explosion caused by revolutionaries. Unrest had begun, but it would take a lot more than that to take down 3 centuries of Romanov rule. His successor, Alexander III, ruled with this threat in mind. His father dead, it was apparent that revolutionaries were out to end the Tsardom. Appeasement would not be tolerated, nor would it be likely even to help. So active countermeasures were taken. Intelligence agencies in an early form arose to find any potential revolutionary actions. It's here that we meet this man. He has a Russian name, so I'm not going to try to pronounce it. But he's also known as Sasha, so let's call him that. He was a revolutionary seeking out Alexander III's death. Him, along with other revolutionaries, prepared to kill the Tsar as he paid his respects to his father in 1887. However, the intelligence agency had gotten word and rounded up the group. Alexander III offered the option that if the group were more or less claiming their actions were wrong, their punishment would be spared. Sasha refused, and he was hanged. Why is this important? Well, Sasha was the older brother of Vladimir Lenin. With his brother dead at the hands of Russia, Vladimir was obviously upset. He took up the same path as his older sibling, joining revolutionary movements for the few decades. But in the meantime, the Tsardom had its own troubles. Alexander III, at a relatively young age of 49, died. As with any dynasty, dying too young can be a major issue. Alexander III's son, Nicholas II, was not too young at the age of 26, but he grew up in a life of luxury without struggle. He had not experienced enough, nor knew enough, to rule Russia. And it's here that the fall of Russia begins. War with Japan in 1904 and 1905, the causes of which are not important to this, puts the Tsar's capabilities to the test. Russia loses, and this is a pretty big deal back in the early 1900s. Asian militaries were seen as greatly inferior to the more developed nations, and this loss began to promote the idea that the Tsar was not capable, nor his rule ordained by God. Soldiers were frustrated, or dead, and the public viewed him in a pretty negative light. What would follow would cement this. Protesters had gathered outside the Winter Palace under relatively peaceful circumstances. They had petitioned for more fair work environments, and while they approached the Tsar's palace, they were gunned down by the Tsar's guards. Word spread quickly. A non-revolutionary group was killed for no good reason, and the public's doubts for the Tsar turned to anger. So as the next decade passed, another war nailed this in even harder. World War I was a complete mess for Russia. Not enough supplies, weapons, and the Tsar gave himself military control rather than his experienced generals. With over 3 million dead, revolution went from the mind of a few to the lives of many. Some more bad publicity came with a mysterious man visiting the palace every day. Long hair and somewhat odd appearance for someone visiting the Tsar, rumors began spreading about his influence on the royal family. His name was Rasputin. In reality, the Tsar had hired him to heal his ill son. Whether he was mystic or not, or helped at all, is irrelevant. The extended family of the Romanovs were pretty embarrassed and horrified by the possible influence of this outsider. Worst of all, some suspected he may be a German, contacting the Tsar regularly during this time of war. So, he was killed. By 1917, the problems of Russia's Tsardom began to boil over. Horrific working conditions and pay, a starving public, and the loss of millions of lives had caused the final ousting of the Tsar. Well, not exactly. He resigned, believing it would end public animosity and that he was in some way doing a noble act. He immediately attempted to nominate a new czar, which obviously declined. The public was not just done with Nicholas II, they were done with the czardom in general. This was the February Revolution. From here, a provisional government was set up in the Tsar's place. It wasn't alone, though. The people of Russia were no longer content with this aristocracy. And as such, a socialist governing body also arose, the Petrograd Soviet. They both had control over Russia now, but the differences between the two parties were impossible to reconcile. Nothing could be done. Too much inefficient bureaucracy that left the nation without a true governing body. They did get one thing done, though. When the working class protest broke out that July, the government managed to fight back, and in the process arrested the leader of this Bolshevik faction. Here's where we get back to Vladimir Lenin. He was exiled out of the country, but by October and November, the story had changed. The Bolsheviks had gained a sizable amount of power within the Petrograd Soviets. Eliminating the opposition would ensure complete revolution, and with that, the power amassed by Bolshevik soldiers and leaders led to true revolution. Lenin returned. This was known as the October Revolution, which actually happened in November due to the Gregorian calendar being adopted later. The Bolsheviks had Russia. Well, not uncontested. Two forces, the socialist Bolsheviks and a more diverse white army, fought. Bolshevik mentality was to silence any political idea outside socialism, and within Russia there was still a good chunk of the population that disagreed. World War I was over, the Soviets made a peace treaty, but this civil war had just begun. In response to this socialist disagreements, former middle class and Tsar loyalists were executed in an event known as the Red Terror. With the secrecy of Russia, this death toll could be anything from thousands to millions. Over the next 5 years, the Soviets' Red Army and the White Army had clashed for control, and obviously we know which side won. The resulting death toll varies, but it's certainly over 5 million people. Through brutal means and near genocide, Lenin finally had control of Russia, but he was also quite ill. During a surgery, he had a stroke and effectively left his high state of power. He still had control, but he was debilitated and knew death was close. With this, he wrote what is known as Lenin's Testament, which intended to function as a layout for the future of Russia. As for leader, it was apparent two options existed: Leon Trotsky, the commander of the Red Army, and General Secretary of the Communist Party, Joseph Stalin. In this document, Lenin makes it clear he wants Stalin removed from office, and with that, Trotsky would rule. But Stalin got word of the document early, and through political scheming, had it hidden from Russia's Congress. Trotsky was quite the adversary for Stalin. He was critical of his actions in the past, and certainly was more qualified to run the country. Stalin, though, he was willing to do anything for power. Stalin had powerful allies, and keeping Lenin's testament secret meant that he was assured control after Lenin died. Trotsky was treated like any other political enemy, exiled and written out of Russian history. So there you go, the Soviet Union. To go from the authoritarian Tsar to the authoritarian Soviets. Millions of lives gone, and that's just the beginning. Whereas prior, the Tsar had authority, but not quite the power to enforce his iron will. The Soviets had the authority, and they had the power. This is Tyler of Knowledge Hub.
This video was inspired by a lecture which was featured in the video service The Great Courses Plus, History of Russia, taught by Professor Mark Steinberg. Here he discusses the general history of Russia from its origins to the modern day. You can access this and many numerous courses through The Great Courses Plus. It's a subscription on-demand video learning service with over 8,000 video lectures taught by professors in basically every field. Topics like science, history, math, and even really specific and odd topics that continue to always be updated, like photography. Courses are sometimes even hosted by National Geographic and the Smithsonian. It removes the pressure of grades from college. All you have to do is just watch and listen. So if you ever want to learn more about the history of Russia, especially the Bolshevik Revolution, click on this link to get 1 month of unlimited access to courses and videos absolutely free. Just visit thegreatcoursesplus.com/knowledge. The link is provided in the description below. This is Cody of Knowledge Hub.